Well, first of all, let me say thank you. Thank you for your prayers and your support as Greg, Chuck, and I spent some time, a couple weeks, ministering among refugees in the Middle East. And Chuck and I traveled home, got in early Tuesday morning. Greg stayed for a few more weeks to serve there. And so keep him in your prayers. I bring greetings from the pastor and the church. They truly appreciate the brotherhood of our churches and the fact that we as a church here can partner with them and come alongside them. And they actually, because of being able to stream our service, they're able to watch our service even though they don't speak English. It doesn't make a whole lot of sense to them somewhat, but they can worship with us. We were there listening to services in Arabic. We didn't understand it either. So it's okay. It works. But I look forward to sharing more about the trip with you. But for now, just wanted to extend greetings from the church and blessings from our brothers and sisters in Christ there. So thank you again for your prayers and support. We're going to be in Luke chapter 22 this morning, verses 31 to 46. And as you're turning there, it's on page 882 if you're using the chairs provided. The Bible's provided for you in the chairs. Just want to say, as we come to a text this morning of Scripture that is kind of holy ground in some ways, the prayer of Christ in the Garden of Gethsemane is where we're going to be this morning. And I'll be honest, I feel completely insufficient to preach this word today for a number of reasons, but this is such a powerful text, and this week as I was studying it, just the heaviness of this particular text of Scripture. We often think of the cross as the place where the great spiritual battle took place, and it was. I mean, the cross is where the Holy One, the one who is fully God and fully man, the eternal second person of the Trinity, he went, he was righteous, he was holy, and he was put on the cross, and he bore our sin, and he fought the spiritual battle there, and it was a place of spiritual and physical agony. And we're gonna get to that in short measure. Next week, as we continue in Luke 22, will be the betrayal of Judas, and we're getting there. But I would say the spiritual battle took place in the garden. What we're going to look at today is presenting for us a spiritual battle that Christ fought, but also a spiritual battle that you and I continue to fight in a different way. And it's not going to be a happy sermon. I'm just going to warn you, if you're here for a happy-go-lucky sermon, I'm sorry. It's going to, if it punches you in the gut like it punched me in the gut this week, the Spirit's at work, hopefully. So with that in mind, let me pray for us, and then we'll take a look at the text and see the very real threat that faces us and our need to be persistent and constant in prayer. Let's pray. Almighty God, Heavenly Father, glorious Son, precious Holy Spirit, thank you. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your strength. Thank you for going before us, meeting us in our need, strengthening us. Lord, we need you. Far too often we walk through our daily lives thinking we got it. We don't. Remind us this morning, Father, as we look into your word, that we need you. We need to run to you. Take this mouth and use it for your glory today. Be magnified, Father, as I preach your word. Amen. Luke 22, verse 31 through 46. Let me read it for us. Follow along as I read. And just some of the context. This is the night that Jesus will be betrayed by Judas. Jesus has told the disciples what's ahead. He's celebrated the Passover meal with them. And at the Passover meal, he took the bread and the cup, symbols that reminded the Jewish people of the Passover lamb that was sacrificed and its blood was shed so they would be rescued, that they would be set free from Egypt, and that they would have be brought in as God's people. And Jesus said, "This is now my body, my blood, broken and shed for you, that you might be rescued from slavery to sin and brought in as God's people." And we're going to celebrate communion today as that reminder, that celebration of what God has done. He's told them that one of them will betray him. Judas has already, because of his own hard heart and because of the influence of Satan, he has already gone and sold himself out to betray Judas. The plot has been formed. The plot is underway. And before the night is done, Judas will go and kiss his teacher. I won't say Lord anymore because it's no longer his Lord. His friend, in a kiss of betrayal. Ryan took us through the text right before this last week. He did a great job last Sunday where the disciples were arguing about who's going to be the greatest in the kingdom. And Jesus confronts them about their pride and their need to walk with humility. And then he turns, and this is what he says now. After saying that they were so filled with pride and they wanted to be the greatest, now Jesus says, "Simon, Simon, behold, Satan demanded to have you, that he might sift you like wheat. But I've prayed for you that your faith may not fail. And when you have turned again, strengthen your brothers." Peter said to him, "Lord, I am ready to go with you, both to prison and to death." And Jesus said, "I tell you, Peter, the rooster will not crow this day until you deny three times that you know me." And he said to them, "When I sent you out with no money bag or knapsack or sandals, did you lack anything?" They said, "Nothing." He said to them, "Bring now. But now let the one who has a money bag take it, and likewise a knapsack. And let the one who has no sword sell his cloak and buy one. For I tell you that the scripture must be fulfilled in me, and he was numbered with the transgressors. For what is written about me has its fulfillment." And they said, "Look, Lord, we have here are two swords." And he said to them, "It's enough." And he came out and went, as was his custom, to the Mount of Olives. And the disciples followed him. And when he came to the place, he said to them, "Pray that you may not enter into temptation." And he withdrew from them about a stone's throw and knelt down and prayed, saying, "Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done." And there appeared to him an angel from heaven strengthening him. And being in agony, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down to the ground. And when he arose from prayer, he came to the disciples and found them sleeping for sorrow. And he said to them, "Why are you sleeping? Rise and pray that you may not enter into temptation." It's interesting. Jesus just confronted them about arguing about who's the greatest in the kingdom. The sin of pride was such an evident thing. And then he says these words in the beginning of verse 31, "Simon, Simon, behold." And he begins with saying Simon's name twice, and it's that intimacy. And he says, "Behold." In essence, there's an emphasis here. Listen to what I'm about to say. This is important. And then what's interesting is then he says, "Satan has demanded to sift you," and that "you" is plural. So he's speaking now, even though he's addressed Simon, he's speaking to the whole group of disciples. Satan has demanded to sift you as wheat. I mean, think about that. And that word "demanded" is a reminder that Satan, he's not all-powerful. He is subject to the authority and the sovereignty of God, and he has to go to God and ask for permission. In essence, what Satan is doing here, Satan is begging, that's the word, he's praying earnestly for the disciples. Just get that picture in your mind. Satan is begging God Almighty to have permission to go after the disciples. He already has Judas. Now he wants the rest of them. And then the picture, Jesus says, to sift you as wheat. The picture of sifting wheat, they would take the grain and they'd beat it and they'd smash it. And they throw it up in the air, and the kernel would separate from the chaff, but the whole process of sifting was violent. And Jesus is telling him, Satan has begged the Father for you to destroy you. Is that sobering? That should put them quaking in their sandals. I was going to say quaking in their boots, but they wore sandals. Here's the reality. What does Scripture tell us? Ephesians chapter 6. You and I are in a spiritual battle. We're to gird ourselves with the armor of God. Why? Because we are in a battle against spiritual forces. Satan wants to destroy you as well. And he's pleading with God Almighty to come and attack you. 1 Peter 5 says that he is like a roaring lion roaming around seeking whom he can devour. What Jesus says here in verse 31 to the disciples applies to you and me. Satan does not want your well-being. Satan is our adversary. He is our tempter. He's the destroyer. He's the liar. He is the father of lies. And he's going to come dressed as an angel of light so that he can deceive you and destroy you. And that's his purpose. That's his goal. And if it doesn't make you shake a little bit, I don't think you fully understand what Jesus just said here. And I don't know why in God's sovereignty, he just doesn't put an end to it. I know one day he will, but for right now, in this particular time, in this dispensation of time, God is saying, I will allow Satan to go and attack. But notice the promise. The next verse, what does Jesus say? But I have prayed for you. Now here it's singular. So here he actually shifts from the whole disciples and he's going to Peter, and he says, I have prayed for you, Peter, that your faith would not fail, that you would return, that you're going to repent, and you're going to come back, and when you come back, you'll strengthen your brothers. Understand what's going on. Peter was probably the first among equals. We could call him that way. He was the leader of the bunch. And Satan knows if he can take out the leader, he'll take out a whole group. And so he's going to go after Peter, hoping if he can knock Peter off his pedestal, if he can take him down, the whole group will be gone. And what Jesus is saying, Satan's prayed to have you. I've prayed for you as well. That when you fail, you'll repent, and you'll come back, and you'll strengthen your brothers. And that reminds us of some great promises too. Romans tells us the Holy Spirit intercedes for us. He prays for us. Hebrews tells us Jesus is our great high priest. And in Hebrews chapter 4, it says he was without sin, yet he was tempted in every respect as we are tempted. So he knows our weaknesses. He knows what we deal with. And therefore, we can come to the throne of grace and find help in time of need because he's praying for us. Hebrews chapter 7 says he is a priest permanently, continually offering up prayers for us, making intercession for us before the throne of grace. What an amazing promise we have in Scripture. Satan wants to destroy you, but Jesus is praying for you. If you take nothing out, I want something else for you to take out of the sermon, but that's powerful. Right there in those two verses. A powerful reminder about the battle we're in, but also a wonderful reminder about the Savior that we have. That little interaction should have kind of shaken them up a little bit. But then we get a window into Peter. And Peter's a picture of you and me, right? What does Peter say? Lord, I'm ready. I'm going to go to prison. I'll even die for you. Oh, Peter. But he's so much like you and me, isn't it? We're told that Satan wants to destroy us, that temptation is coming, that trials are coming, and what do? Well, I can overcome that. I can get over my anger problem. I can get over my drinking problem. I can stop, you know, gossiping. I can stop looking at stuff I shouldn't be looking at. I can. And we pull ourselves up by our own bootstraps, even though we don't have bootstraps anymore, and we say, I'm good enough to do this, and we're self-sufficient. I can. I'm ready. And we're just like Peter. Lord, I know I'm going to be tempted, but whew, I'm ready. No, you're not. Look what Jesus says, Peter, before the night is over, you're going to deny even knowing me three times. Peter, you're relying on yourself. The spirit may be willing, but the flesh is weak, and before the night is over, you're going to fail. And when we're facing temptation and trials, we cannot, here we got to, listen to this, we cannot do this on our own. We're just not strong enough. Satan is under God's authority. He cannot do anything he's not permitted to do, but he's more powerful than you and me. And he's not an adversary to be played with. And when he or his demons attack, you and I can't go, I'm good. I'm ready. No, you're not. We're just not strong enough. That doesn't mean that we don't prepare, we don't study God's word, we don't... No, the next few verses, take a look what Jesus does here in verses 35 through 38. Jesus reminds them that he sent them out at one point and said, don't take anything with you, don't take any provisions, don't do it, you'll be provided for. But now as the word of God would be fulfilled, he says the word is going to be fulfilled, that the Messiah will be numbered among the transgressors, okay? So this is the fulfillment of Isaiah 53, the servant song in Isaiah, and it's a messianic passage of scripture pointing ahead to the Messiah who will be counted among the transgressors. He'll be counted among the criminals, and Jesus knows he's going to be crucified on a cross. That was the death of a criminal. He's going to be hung between two criminals, fulfilling scripture, and what he's saying is with that also is going to come a new wave of persecution. And in fact, he at one point, when the disciples said, you know, why can't we go with you? And he said, can you drink the cup that I'm going to drink? Can you go through the baptism I'm going to go through? And they said, we can. And he says, no, you can't, but you will. What Jesus is saying is there's a cup of persecution coming. There's a baptism persecution coming. Get ready for it. Trials and temptations are coming. Get ready for them. I sent you out before with no knapsack, no money bag, no purse, nothing like that. Now take a money bag. Take a knapsack. Go get a sword. And Jesus is using these pictures of a person who's ready for the journey, ready to travel. He doesn't mean literally. He's saying, get ready. You've got a tough journey ahead. Get prepared. Now, you're not going alone, but get prepared. Are we ready for the journey? Are we ready for the temptations? Are we ready for the trials? I pray that we are. I pray that we're in God's word, studying his word, and having our hearts prepared, that we're getting ready for the journey. Not relying on our own strength. And as we come to the end there, they say, I love this, verse 38, look, Lord, here are two swords. Again, they misunderstood the point. And think about it. They were just told Satan is going to sift them as wheat, and they think two swords are going to be enough. I love the disciples because they're so much like us. I would have been there with them. Hey, look, hey, he said swords. We got two. They're counting up the swords, and they think it's good. And Jesus says, it is enough. And you know, you can read that and go, well, Jesus is saying two swords is enough. No, that phrase is kind of like a phrase of saying, enough. Enough. You're missing the point. It's not about swords, boys. It's about the spiritual battle that's ahead. Are you ready? Are you prepared for the journey? And we need to make every effort to put away sin in our lives and follow Christ wholeheartedly, but our strength will always come up short. We need to run to the Lord. We must be persistent and constant in prayer. The scene shifts in verse 39 to remind us of our need for prayer. We're in a spiritual battle. Satan wants to destroy us. Our strength is not enough. In verse 39, now the scene shifts to the Garden of Gethsemane. And kind of holy ground here. as Jesus will go before the Father and pray. And notice what it says here. Luke tells us he goes to the Mount of Olives, and if you're familiar with some of the layout of Jerusalem, Jerusalem on the eastern wall is where the Temple Mount stands, and then right from the wall you go through the Kidron Valley up to the Mount of Olives, and at the base of the Mount of Olives is the Garden of Gethsemane. And they were in the city for the Passover meal, and now they're making the journey across the Kidron Valley to the Garden of Gethsemane. Look what Luke says. They go there as was his custom. A couple things here. One, Judas now knows where to take the mob. Right, so this is now a location. 2 weeks ago, as Pastor Mike preached through the upper room and the Passover meal, if you were here, you might remember him saying that he told two of his disciples to go and set it all up, and Judas wasn't one of them, so that he could enjoy the meal without Judas bringing the crowd. Now, Jesus is going where it was his custom to go. Jesus is still in control, and the timing of Judas's betrayal is even according to God's plan. He goes where it was his custom to go. Judas knew it. Judas knew he would go where he would pray. I had the privilege of going where they believe is the Garden of Gethsemane and seeing the trees that are there, the olive trees. Some they say may even date back to close when Jesus was there. One of those trees may have been where Jesus was leaning up against one of those trees. I don't know. Whatever. But it was kind of cool to be in that quiet place and imagine that that's where Jesus lay down before the Father and prayed in an excruciating prayer. It was his custom to go there to pray. You see, Jesus was regularly in prayer. We see that throughout the Gospels. Jesus was praying, regularly praying. If God, the Son, fully God and fully man, needed to go to the Father constantly in prayer, how much more do you and I? And notice what he says to his disciples in verse 40. Pray. Pray that temptation. Pray that you may not enter in temptation, verse 40. And when we look at the command is, he's reminding, in fact, that the word pray there is a present imperative. It's a command with kind of an ongoing command. Pray, keep praying, pray, pray, pray. He comes back to him in verse 46 with the same thing. And as a reminder, keep praying, pray without ceasing. Keep praying. The battle is not going to end. Keep praying. So he commands his disciples in the face of trial and temptation to pray. And notice that now on the night he's going to be arrested, tried, and crucified in the face of trial and temptation, he didn't rest in his own strength. He prayed to the Father. Friends, we take prayer for granted. I heard a little bit of the Sunday school class in the book of Acts. And as I was hearing a little bit, we were talking about prayer this morning and how the disciples, and this is a beautiful thing, they kind of learned their lesson. The book of Acts shows us they kind of learned their lesson. We'll get to that in just a bit. But what is prayer? Prayer is our communication. It's our communion with God. Think about that. God allows us, through Christ, to come into his presence. The almighty, eternal, triune, all-powerful, holy God of all creation, who made everything, rules over everything, who's sovereign over everything, says, come into my presence. In fact, he says, I want you to come. And we have a picture in Revelation where the prayers of the saints, the prayers of you and me, it's incense to God. He loves the scent of it. And yet we find it so hard to do. We know it's valuable. I would say it's an essential ministry of the church. In fact, one of the beautiful things that we have a ministry here at Faith, just a little bit of an advertisement, we have a ministry here at Faith, and that's where the power of ministry is. There's a group of people somewhere in this building right now committed to praying, and they're praying for you, they're praying for me as I preach, they're praying for the Spirit to be at work in us. I would encourage you, if there's one ministry you do in the church, become part of the prayer team that prays every Sunday morning and prays for them, because that's an essential ministry of the church. There's a spiritual battle going on. We need you to pray. So that's a little advertisement. So this sermon is brought to you by the prayer team. Yeah, anyway, so. Jesus knew the disciples needed to pray. He warned them to pray. And then Jesus gives an example in this passage for us. Jesus fully understood the trial as before him. He knew the physical beating that he would bear. He understood the excruciating death by crucifixion that he was going to suffer at the hands of the Romans. He knew what that meant. He knew the shame and the mockery that was going to be cast upon him in the coming hours. But probably the most terrifying thought is that he knew that though he was righteous and without sin, that the sin of humanity, your sin or mine, would be placed upon him. He knew that he was going to bear the wrath of God for sin. And for the first time in eternity, the fellowship of the Trinity would be broken because of our sin. That spiritual suffering was so much more excruciating than the physical suffering he was about to bear. He knew what was ahead. And so he goes to the Father and look at his prayer. If this cup could be removed from me, if there's another way, if there's a way that sin could be dealt with, if there's another way of forgiveness, if there's a way of redeeming the lost, if there's a way of bringing humanity back, if there's a way of bringing our people to us, if there's a way of winning them back, if, then let it be. But not my will, Father, yours be done. You see, in that time of prayer, he's coming before, and maybe you've had those nights of excruciating prayers. You're watching a loved one suffering with some form of disease or injury, or when you don't know what to do, or a relationship has been severed, and you're just hurting, and you're crying out, if you would, I know you can heal my mom, I know you can heal my spouse, I know you can heal my child, if you would. But take this heart and make it yours. Shape my will according to your will, Father. And that's the battle that's going on with Christ right here. And notice that God responds, God the Father responds by strengthening Jesus. Where the disciples were sleeping and no human could have come to his aid at that moment, God himself, through prayer, comes and strengthens Christ, and then Christ keeps on pleading and praying to the point of praying so intensely, it says that he was sweating, was like drops of blood. Now, I know there's all kinds of debate, and some say, well, was he really sweating blood? Medically, it's a possibility. Or was he sweating drops like blood? Let me just tell you this, it doesn't matter. The point that Scripture is making for us was his prayer was so intense that was how much he's praying, Lord, Father, if it can be removed, but if not, so be it, let your will be done. That's where the spiritual battle took place. Jesus rose from that moment of prayer to face the cross willingly for you and me without faltering. You see, it was in prayer that he found that strength. There's a lesson for you and me. May we run to the Father in prayer. And we need to be constant and persistent in prayer. The last two verses present for us a picture. Put it all together, right? Jesus just said, Satan, your adversary, wants to sift you as wheat. Prayed for you. Get prepared. Pray. Pray that you may not fall into temptation. And what do? They're out cold. They're sleeping. Now, they were exhausted. In fact, Luke tells us they were exhausted from sorrow. Think about what this week had been like already. Hey, this was an intense week of ministry, following Jesus, all that's going on, all that Jesus said. It's been intense, and so it's no surprise that they are exhausted physically, spiritually. And we need to rest. We need to sleep. But that sleep is even more than just physical sleep. They were spiritually just sleeping. And Jesus is saying, stop sleeping and wake up. There's a spiritual battle. You need to pray. Pray that you don't fall into temptation. We have the benefit of knowing what happens. They didn't pray. In just a moment, Judas is going to come with the mob. The disciples are going to disperse. They're going to flee. Peter, who made the declaration, I'm ready to go to prison to even die for you, he's going to follow behind. He's going to be challenged by even a servant girl at a fire. And like, oh, well, I don't know. He's even going to curse. I don't bleep in know him. Three times he's going to deny even knowing Jesus before the night is through. And the beautiful thing is they learn their lesson. Acts, the book of Acts, I would give this homework assignment. Go home today, read through the book of Acts. Just look for the number of times it talks about prayer. From chapter 1 on through, they understood by that point they needed to be devoted to prayer. In fact, in Acts chapter 4, or Acts chapter 6, as there's a debate in the church, the apostles say, no, we can't be distracted. Our ministry has to be the ministry of the word and the ministry of prayer. Because they understood the importance of it, to be devoted to prayer. And they go on and write for us. They tell us these things. Ephesians chapter 6, the passage of spiritual warfare, we're to pray at all times in the midst of spiritual warfare. 1 Thessalonians 5:17, pray without ceasing. Romans 12:12, be constant in prayer. Philippians 4, rejoice always. Don't be anxious, but pray. I could go on. James 5, Hebrews 4, 1 Peter 5. It goes on. It's a recurring theme throughout the New Testament. Pray. Don't stop. Pray. It is your battleground. Pray. And you've heard this. If you've been in the church for any time, you've heard this before. And this is what's been challenging me. How often do we wake up, run into our day, and we don't say any word of prayer? And maybe we throw out a cursory little thank you, Lord, for this food before a meal. And we say, Lord, I need you, but yet in our prayerlessness, we say, no, I got this. We're like Peter. I'm ready. I'm ready, God. I got it. I hope, I pray that we'd be a people of prayer. Recognizing that if God's going to work in our midst, if God's going to work in our lives, if he's going to do anything, we need to run to him. He wants us to come to him. It shows our dependence on him. It shows him that we know we're dependent upon him. And we need to go to him in prayer. One of the things that impressed me so much over the past few months as I prepared for this missions trip was the dependence upon the Lord that Greg showed in prayer. If you know Greg, Greg Donnelly, if you know him, you know that he has a deep love for the Lord. But he understands our dependence on the Lord. And so prayer was not something we did at the beginning and end of our meetings. Prayer was in the middle. We would talk about some stuff and we'd pray. We'd talk about some stuff and we'd pray. We'd talk about some stuff and we'd pray. We're driving down to Dulles Airport, and as we're driving out, I got cut off. And my first response was, oh man, I can't believe this guy. He's, cutting me off like that. And I didn't say anything really bad. Greg's first response was, let's pray. Let's pray for him. Let's pray for us. While we were on the trip, we understood that prayer was essential for what God was doing in the church, what God was doing in our ministry, for our own safety while we were there. We needed to be praying. That was impressed on me as I saw it lived out in my brother, and he would say he's not a prayer warrior. When we're facing temptation, pray for strength. When we're facing trials, we need to pray for God's will to be done. And for strength, when we need wisdom, pray for wisdom. When we're worried and anxious, we need to pray. When we're excited and something good's happened, we need to pray with rejoicing and celebration. We need to be persistent and constant in prayer. Satan is your adversary. He's a very real threat. Christ is praying for you. But we're to pray and not give up praying. So let's do that now. Let's pray. Father, forgive us for the many times when we tell you we got it. Whether we say it in our own words or we say it by our prayerlessness, Lord, we know we need you. We cannot do this on our own. Lord, thank you for this reminder. And I pray that it's not just a nice little sermon. I pray that your Spirit's at work in us to make this truth a reality in how we live out our days. Lord, I pray that we would be a people with sleepless nights of prayer. Because we're dependent on you. Move in us. Transform us. Know that we need you. And may we run to you. Amen.
If you have questions about what you've just heard, or if you want to know more about what it means to follow Jesus Christ, I would encourage you to check out our website, faithbfc.org. If you live in the Harleysville area and you're not part of a local church, we'd love to have you worship with us here at Faith. I look forward to meeting with you personally. But whether you live here or somewhere else, the important thing is to get plugged into a local church where you can grow in your walk with Jesus Christ and help others grow as you serve Him.